can top that. You get up here now. I want you to come up here right now, because we're not going to be here all day and all night, because the family wants some time later on. And I'm going to give them all the time. And they said, Pastor Cross, we can't be here all day. And they mentioned we got some family members that can go on and on and on and on and on and on and on. And so we're going to respect it, okay? I'm giving everybody the time to come up here that needs to, so that the people standing up here, they will realize that I've been talking a long time, which means that y'all have been standing a long time, so they're going to be respectful. I'm trying to make it very easy for us to sit as a family. Amen?
Amen.
All right, come on, Pastor.
God bless. My name is on the program, and Eddie was my best friend, and still is. I met Eddie in 1972. When you first came to Detroit, I was here. And we had something growing. He let me know that he's from Georgia. I let him know I'm from North Carolina. Those two places, there was a spiritual connection, because I was from the old path and the old road, cornfield, dirt roads, and the mules, and he was also from the same environment. So we hitched up together, we got along. Even back then when I wasn't saved, I didn't get drunk and cuss him out. He didn't get drunk and cuss me out. So we always have a relationship. I wasn't always saved, and he wasn't either. But when we got drunk and pride and stuff, it never was a cussing word or MF word coming out of my mouth towards him, or he coming towards me. You had that relationship. You had it. And then there was a time that my brother had passed. He was my best friend. My wife, my small son, and my daughter, and Eddie was in the back seat of the car. And my twin brother was in the front, and I was in the front, and his girlfriend was in the front. It was a Ford Mattery, one of the small type of cars. So we've been celebrating our birthday on July the 5th. And after we left there, his place, down the highway, of course we were a little tipsy, and I probably fell asleep, whatever. But anyway, as he was going around the curb on 75 down by Outer Drive, coming toward Detroit, the car flipped over. And when he flipped over, last thing I hear him say, he said, yeah, get us out. So he died in that crash. And the other day I was thinking, because if the car flipped over, my wife, my baby, my son, which was a year old, and my daughter, which was about 3 or 4 years old, they had to go between the back window of the car in order to get out. That's how the car flipped right over. And it pinned us in. So I was pinned in, and he died, and I was in hospital, and so forth. But from then, I was thinking of the night. From then, that's when I thought about past tense. I said, God took my brother, left me and Eddie. And from that time, our experience and our love for one another became that much tighter. Much tighter. But then, I didn't realize that until a couple of days ago. And here lately, I've been going by and see Eddie White was sick. We sit and talk. Sometimes we didn't talk. We just sit there and we look at one another, watch TV, and we used to work in together on construction projects and did things together, did multiple things together. Went on trips down Kentucky. We went everywhere just together. And we had a relationship. And to the family, to Starla and her three children. My children is much older than theirs, except for one. I had children, my children were grown, and then later on, Eddie had children, and his family was the life of his heart. It was his heartbeat. He was a man of integrity. He had understanding, he had compassion, he had wisdom. So just give me to say right now, I'd like to read the scripture, if I may. Yes. I'm going to close it off.
If you make it quick.
Scripture is this. From Romans, the 5th chapter, it says, therefore, being justified by faith, we have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ, by whom also we have access by faith to his grace, wherein we stand, and rejoice in the hope of the glory of God. And not only so, but we glory in tribulation also, knowing that tribulation work patience, and patience experience, and experience hope, and the hope make not ashamed, because the love of God is shed abroad in our heart by the Holy Spirit, which is given unto us.
That's so pretty. Amen. It did pretty good, right? Pretty good. All right, come on up.
He dropped something.
He dropped something. No, that's mine. All right. Well, how y'all doing out there? Y'all see that picture right there? I'm sitting in the back, and that picture's staring me right now. Boy, don't you get up there and mess up. But let me tell you something. When I met Eddie, I was going through some hard times. Mm. I was big as I am. I was a bodybuilder. I was angry. Mm. And Eddie said, boy, you too strong to be too mad. Mm. And he said, he took me under his wing. And he said, let me tell you something. It's easy to go out here and get in trouble. It's hard to get out of.
Mm. That's good. That's wisdom. Okay. That's wisdom.
And I had a talent. I was a cook at Northfield. He had a talent with his hands. We all, everybody here is blessed with a talent. Yes. Eddie's talent was patience. Wow. And every time I come by the house, you see my family right there? Sweet Mama, Star, Gabriel, Angela, Ariana. When I, me and my family separated, there they go. So I just want to say thanks.
That's good. That's really good.
Before you say something, you got a Band-Aid?
Well, you know what?
No, do you have any Band-Aids?
I ain't cutting sick.
No, but anybody that's sharp?
I got one.
Am I right about it? He got one in his briefcase. I know he did. Is he looking good? What? Come on.
Thank you. Good evening, everybody. How y'all doing? I'm Eddie Brooke. I'm the eighth child of the family. Eighth one of the world, the weird world, and wonder. Y'all wonder what I'm about to say, right? My brother, I love him so much. I want to cry every day because I told myself every day, I told my brother, my sister, everybody, I got to go see my brother before he got sick. Before he got sick, because I had so many headaches and pain and stuff I've been going through. But I didn't expect my brother to get sick like this. I told him last time I'd be back when I was in church, that we did my birthday thing here. Took pictures and everything. I lost a lot of pictures, the phone, whatever. But I'm not trying to hold y'all down. Just y'all think that I'm going to keep coming up here for no reason. The next time I come up here, I'm going to try to find me a place to stay of my own. But I can do with my brother being a little better because he want me to do something in life. And I said, while he's laying there on that bed, he never answered me back. But if y'all could just tell me what my brother would want me to do, it's gonna be done. That's what, no matter what, it's gonna be done. And God is good to me and my family, and I know that. Because it's 10 of us, he's the first one that left us. I said, my dad. But it's so much in my heart, I want to say to folks, I can't not say everything at one time. I just had to write a book. Y'all read the book later. But I want y'all to tell you, I got a story of my life too. But I'm not going to strain part about my life. But everything my brother did, I tried to do what he did. He dressed. My suit cost me $400 or $500. And it ain't got no car, no house, but now I can buy me another one called 800. I'm gonna buy me a suit to wear. I'm gonna wear it to the day I wear. Leave this world. Not I give it to somebody to wear. But my suit calls me. Just like a car note.
I believe.
And I appreciate y'all. And I love y'all. My name is Jerome Harold Davis, Senior. Senior. And I got a son named Jerome Harold Davis Jr. Look like me, but I don't know if he dressed like me. But I got a grandbaby that got named Aiden Jerome Davis. And I hope that baby has some of my talent. Thank y'all, and I fixed cars to the house back off the floor.
Ain't gonna go to the world. Right there. Come on up. No, we got a lot of people. They'll get mad at me if I give you another chance.
I just want to acknowledge.
I know, we're gonna do that, but remember, you said we're gonna respect, I'm trying to respect the family.
Yeah, praise the Lord. first given out of the Christ, who is the head of my life, to Jesus Christ, who is my life, to Pastor Cross and the ministerial staff here. I just want to say I thank God for Starla. Starla and I are best friends, and we've known each other over 20-something years. But what I wanted to say to the family, and I've adopted the children as my nieces and nephew, only on loan. God loans us to each other. And so it behooves us to treat each other like we should, like he says, to love one another, because we don't know how long we'll have each other. Amen? And I just want to say Eddie was laid back and real calm and cool, and Starla just made up the difference. She just kind of completed, because she's a little outspoken and very optimistic, and I love her for that. But one thing I told Starla, one thing about it, she rose to the occasion. I don't know, you know, all beforehand, but when Eddie took ill, Starla rose to the occasion. There was nothing that she didn't do. She didn't miss a beat. She bought furniture. She made him comfortable. Anything he wanted to eat, she took him out. She did. She rose to the occasion, and I believe she made his last days his best days. And I just want to say, Starla, I love you. Keep your head up. You know we're there for you. And now, like you've always been, you can continue to look to the hills from which comes your help. God bless you. I love all of y'all.
Bless you. Thank you. That's how you do it. Say what you need to say. That's good. Like that. Good example. Bless you.
Praise the Lord, everyone. I had just seen Eddie on Christmas Day. I had no idea who was as ill as he was. But Starla family, I've always felt a connection with this family. Starla, I just want to tell you what the scripture says. Blessed are they that mourn, for they shall be comforted. Earth has no sorrow that heaven cannot heal. As I was reading the obituary, I see that Eddie likes The Price is Right. So I'm like, wow, I'm not the only one that likes The Price is Right. In fact, I'm going to try to make that my bucket list this year. But anyway, I just want to say that I love you all. And as the lady said, look to the hills and what's come to your help. Your help coming from the Lord, who created the heavens and the earth. And there's nothing that he cannot do. God bless you all. Okay, hello everybody.
Hello.
I am Starla's big sister. My name is Shonda, they call me Cece. And I remember when Starla met Eddie, and I was like, what's she gonna do with him? She didn't have a lot of guys in her life, so when she got him, I was like, whoa, okay, let's see what he about. And so I was dating this guy at the time, and she did not like him, approve of him or nothing. So she got on this TV show called Kelly and Company. I don't know if y'all remember that show, but it was talking about nosy people who be in your business, and that was my sister. So she got on there and said, the sisters and all of us got together, and we decided he got to go. And I was like, have y'all seen her husband? And so Eddie had to grow on me, so eventually he grew on me. But I lived down the street from him, and he's my brother-in-law. And I actually seen him more than I seen Starla, because he was always at my house. Anything went wrong, he like, need me fix that door. He built a room in my basement. And my husband got a little jealous, like, I can fix that door. I don't need you to fix that door. So Eddie kind of like grew on my husband. So now when I ask him to do something, he step up to the plate a little bit closer. You know, he move on a little bit better. But Eddie was always there for my family, you know, if I needed anything. Like one time I had to call him and pick Sweet Mop from the center. And Eddie was kind of mean to me, so I was kind of scared to ask him. And I was like, Eddie, can you go pick up Sweet Mop for me? He's like, yeah. And I was like, oh, okay, he ain't as bad as I thought he was. Oh, and so, one more story and I'm done. When Starla had Eddie, Starla was sick, so she couldn't bring Angela home from the hospital, so I took Angela home. And the next day I got up, got the baby dress, and was taking Angela to see her mama. And Eddie's like, you gonna do that for us? Like, yeah, why wouldn't I take the baby to see her mama? He teared up a little bit. I got the Starla, she got crying. You brought my baby to see her? I'm like, what's the fuck? Y'all ain't just like, y'all was meant for each other. And that's all I have to say. Thank you. God bless you. Eddie! That's what that picture maker wanted to do, just call his name off. Well, there's one thing I got out of watching Stalin and his relationships. They know who I am.
A couple people.
I'm Stalin's sister. Eddie's sister-in-law. I was once his auntie. I know y'all wonder what's up with that. Don't even worry about it. Right, there you go. Don't even worry about it. But I like the way that relationship turned out, because it was rocky in the beginning. Yeah. It was wild, it was crazy. Eddie used to talk stuff all the time, and I'm like, Eddie, Stalin might not say that, but I'm like, I'm gonna say something. What I'm trying to say is, when I say, you know, their relationship was rocky in the beginning, Eddie started going to church, maybe even before that. Well, what I guess I'm really trying to say, if you just have God in your life, things will work out for you. I better sit down.
Praise the Lord. My name is Cher Connor. I'm actually Eddie Starla's next door neighbor. And been the neighbor for 15 years. Wow. For real? But when I first moved in, Eddie came over. He said, I'll put a fence up. I ain't no height. What kind of person you gonna be? We all put our fence up. And it was a fence. It was, you know, that fence. This little wood fence that he built. And, but he watched out for us, all the single ladies in our area. Eddie watched out for us. In fact, I was trying to tell Starla, I can't remember the last time I saw it, Thanksgiving or what, because I brought a turkey over. But I think it was after Christmas, because he'd peek out the door when I get up in the morning for the kids and see if I'm off on my way. You know, that's how he was our watchman on our block. And, you know, you don't get that.
Double
us.
No.
And he tell the boys, you know, I kept foster kids, though. He one thing about Eddie, and everybody knows this, he's a straight shooter. He gonna tell you the truth. And he said, them doggone kids, yeah. You know, they in and out the windows and everything. He said, oh Lord, and then my boys, they get on his grass. Go on my grass. You know, he loved that grass and cutting that grass. And then when I saw that he wasn't cutting the grass, I said, wow. And then they was like, you know, that's not like Eddie. You know, that grass is like carpet. And so I seen him out there one day trying to push the garbage can back. I said, what you doing, Eddie? Get on in that house. You don't need to be doing all of that. I go over there and pull it out for you. You know, I don't like doing it either, but we look out for each other, you know. And the kids, they call me auntie. I seen them grow up. You know, seeing Angela and them, and I'm really going to miss him. A good man. Yes. Amen.
Getting close to the end. Who is that? You reading the acknowledgments, right? All right. She's the last person. That's too long. He's a good one.
Good afternoon, everyone. My name is Angie Roman. I'm a member here at Rosedale. I'm a friend of Starla's and the family. I didn't get to know Eddie very well, but I would always see him here in church, and he was always smiling whenever I were, you know, running late, he'd be on this side, and he always, if he was right there, scooting stuff over, you know, so I could have a place to sit. So I remember that about him, and I'm appreciating hearing all of the other stories and the things about his life. But what I really, really, really came to say was just something to Starla, and a couple of other sisters before me have already said it, but I just want you to know how proud I am of you and the work that you did in taking care of your husband. And I've been a nurse for almost 20 years in different roles, and I have seen so many families go through. And in that, I've seen a lot of people jump off the ship as soon as they found out that there was a leak in the vessel. And a lot of times it would be families that you never would have expected, you know, that would be going through. So Starla was always right there. She used me as a resource when she could. She told me that, you know, she was busy. She was trying to make sure that her husband had the right care that he needed. When things didn't go the way they needed to go, she pulled the trigger and said, let's go in another direction. And I commend you for that. It happens, but it happens the other way a lot. So God bless you. God bless you all. I know this is a difficult time, but keep your faith in God, as I know you will, and you'll get through it. But just amazing, amazing, amazing.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. Oh, is somebody else jumping that line?
Yes.
They're always testing the pastor, you know what I mean? Family members, whatever. I say the last one, they're going to jump up there anyway. It don't matter. I'm a rep, but I obey the family. So, she really is the last one. Let the church say amen.
Amen.
Here's what I'm telling you. Be sure you're the last one. Don't let nobody else get up there behind you. No, but she's going to do the acknowledgement. She's just going to do the acknowledgement. Again, I'm just doing this out of respect for the family, because the family have a bunch of stuff they want to share later. Okay? And you hungry? I'm like you. And we got some good food too, boy. That's the only thing I like about funerals in this show. We ain't going to the cemetery, so you ain't got to wait that long to get some food. And the food going to be good. Let the church say amen.
Amen.
All right, we're going to have a couple other people, and then we're going to move along. We have a song, and then you're going to hear from the family. I told you it's a different kind of funeral, all right? And so far, most of y'all have been submitting and obeying, because I always got one or two. You always got a member of the family, as always. You know what I mean? You with me? All right, come on.
My name is Roy Harlan. I'm been a neighbor of Eddie for, we moved on the block together about 1995, and we built our houses. And ever since then, me and Eddie has been getting closer and closer. We had, the Bible talks about a friend is closer than a brother. And Eddie was like a brother. Matter of fact, he had one of my brother's name, and his birthday was another one of my brothers. And so me and Eddie, we would, you know, we took care of the block. If anything needed to be boarded up, or anything need grass be cut, I had to have Eddie with me. I had to have him, because if I didn't have him, things wouldn't go right. And he just was, he's been a blessing to me. It was just, I'm going to miss him so much, because I would go sit on the porch. I could always stop and we'd chat for a little while, or he'll come down and sit on the driveway. When he got a little sick, I'll put a chair out for him and make sure he's in the shade. But that was my man. If you look to your right, Eddie built that wall in our church. You know, he was concrete man, but he did that wall, probably one of the best walls in the church. But I just want to say, Starla, I thank you for letting Eddie be with me, be taking him away from you a lot. Gabriel, you've been a blessing. You was a blessing too. My wife was just telling me the other day that she got stuck in front of your house, and you come out and get her out back in the winter that day. So she said, you know, she's been a blessing. The whole family, girls, I see you grow up. I see you grow up, and you're wonderful women and young women. You're going to be great. And remember that I'm still your uncle down the street. Okay? Amen.
Come on, John.
Look at that screen. Don't that look like Plainview? Is that the street y'all live on? If it was good outdoors, see? Don't that remind you of Plainview?
I was reflecting the other day when the time when I first met Eddie, and I was walking to the food service department where he worked, and I asked him a question about someone, and he helped me out. He told me what I needed to know. But what was even more interesting was, even in this short time, was his mannerism and his spirit that made you feel welcome and uninhibited. And I would get to know that person over the next 20 years. And like many here, Eddie did small jobs at my house. And you could always trust that whatever price he gave you, it was fair. And as many have said, I truly feel as if I lost my blood brother.
Mm. Amen. Amen. That's the word. That's the word. Come on up, woman of God.
Praise the Lord. Good afternoon. My name is Minister Benita Cox. I'm from Atlanta, and I am a first cousin of Eddie, and I also call him brother because he was one of the first out of the brothers and sisters of his parents that he was born the male child in this family. And so he went away at an early age, but you know, we all stayed in touch. And out of respect, it was so many people coming up, I was like, well, should I still go up? But I had to obey his sister and say, well, are you gonna speak for the family? And so I said, okay, I have to get up and say something. We all love brother. And we love this family, and we thank every one of you who have got up here and shared your stories and shined the light on Eddie because of the life that he lived. And what I want to say to Stoddy and the children, the brothers and the sisters and all of our family, let's be like Eddie. Let our light shine. Let our gifts be used for the building of one another. And not be selfish, you know, but love each other. And you know, that's one thing, if you see my family now, and just like you know Eddie, we are the same way. You know, what you see is what you get. Because, I mean, we will tell you what you need to know. And we are not shy to speak up. Sometimes I think we speak a little up too much. But you know, that's who we are. But you know, in all, we love each other. We come together. And it's just a blessing to be here and to hear the love of his life and how they have shared their life over the years, the part that we may have not seen. Right. You know, we've seen some of it, but it's just a blessing to be here. And I want to just encourage God to keep on keeping on. Children, people, and you know what? Brothers and sisters and in-law, let's stay together as family. Just because one leaves, we are still to be connected. And I want us to continue to call one another and to reach out and see one another until our day comes when it's time for us to leave. Amen. Thank you.
You're going to do the acknowledgments, right? No, I will cut y'all. During this time, so you need to know that your presence makes a difference. So here's what I want you to do. I was and am his pastor, so I'm going to be your pastor for the next hour or so, and you'll get through it. But I'm different. So before you sit down, hug the person next to you and tell them, I'm glad you're here. And then take a seat.
Can't hug anyone. I'm glad you're here.
I'm glad you're here.
Come on, listen.
I got a huge coat, don't I?
I thought you need me doing this. You need me to do anything.
We got enough seats here. Help us. We need another chair or two.
You got it on pause?
Huh?
You got it on pause?
Reading a prolonged passage of scripture, I just want to draw your attention to a phrase that we find in two passages of scripture. One in Genesis 28, another in Matthew 28. And the phrase is simply this: God is speaking. And he says, I will be with you. He says it to Jacob. Then Jesus says it to his people. I will be with you. I'll explain a little later what that means. When God makes that promise, it means, well, you need to understand that he's not saying that because I'm God, I will prevent these kinds of occasions. A lot of people say, there's God, there's a God. God says, when you find yourself where you're sitting now, I'll be with you. That's the kind of God he knew. That's the kind of God you need to get to know. So as we walk through this valley of the shadow of death, as we walk this last mile of the way, my prayer is that you will experience God with you. That's a serious promise. I will be with you. I'll never leave you nor forsake you. Great life. Great man. Great gift. I'm absolutely convinced, beyond a shadow of a doubt, that when some of us know him as brother, some of you know him as granddaddy, some of you, well, yeah, I know that's inside thing. See, ain't but one or two people who know what that means. Don't bust on them. Some of us know him as neighbor, Mr. Davis, Eddie, regardless of how you know him, when he was born, God had us in mind. Especially when he was born again, God had me in mind. He knew that I would need this kind of member, this kind of usher, this kind of friend. You would need this kind of neighbor, this kind of father, this kind of husband, this kind of brother, this kind of uncle. And so just a few days ago, there's a phrase on his life that says, return to sender. So he's back with the person who sent him to us. Let's give God a hand clap of praise for sending us his life. I think it's a genius idea. I think it's a great idea to send him to us. Can the church say amen?
Amen.
I'm going to ask Deacon English, if she'll come now and lead us in prayer as we acknowledge.
It is a pleasure to be here in the house of the Lord this morning. We serve an awesome and mighty God. And I just want to say a few things about Ed. He was a gatekeeper. Pastor Cross mentioned that he was an usher. I call them gatekeepers. They're the first people you meet when you're coming to the church. There's something about his smile as he stood there so firm and planted so solid. I remember Starla looking up one day while he was on duty. She had a big grin on her face. Nobody but God. Do you understand what I'm saying? Nobody but God. Then I was reminded after the long years of marriages, a man that finds a wife finds a good thing, and obtains favor from the Lord? Boy, oh boy, how much favor that sister had with that brother. That's worth saying hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Amen. Yes. For a marriage to last this long in Christ Jesus, come on and talk to me. Yes. Talk to me. I'm not one of them saints that's going to be quiet. That's something to shout about. Because the Lord brought them together. That was His doing. Started with that smart at 19. It was. God is good. And out of that union came great fruit. Those children that loved their mom and their dad. That again was something to shout about. That was done by the Lord. That was special intention for him to be here in this body of baptized believers at this point in his life, at this time, to be the gatekeeper of this church. Saints, are you ready? Are you? Or are you playing at church? What are you doing? What is your relationship with the Lord Jesus Christ this day? We know where Eddie is. To be absent from the body is to be present with the Lord. And for that we say hallelujah, hallelujah, and amen. Now if you will bow your heads with me. Dear gracious and heavenly Father, we come into your presence with humble hearts, with an attitude of gratitude. For Lord, you've done great and mighty things in the Davis family. You've done great and mighty things in Eddie's life. Oh God, we praise and acknowledge you are the sovereign one. You are great and mighty, God, and we lift you up. We thank you for his life. We thank you for ordering his steps. Yea, though his family walks through the valley of the shadow of death, just as the pastor said, you are with them. God, you will never leave them, nor will you forsake them. You are a God that is worthy of all our praise. And this day, we're not saddened with hearts, or we'll miss it. But when we look up, when we step forward, we step out, we'll be encouraged because, Lord, you've richly enriched their lives as brothers and sisters and daughters and as wives. God, we praise and acknowledge that you are the sovereign and great and mighty God. We thank you for him being the presence in this church. We thank you, Lord, for the opportunity to serve together. We thank you, Lord, for what you're doing and how you're doing. Continue to meet them where they are, dear God, because you are a God of all comfort that will comfort those at any time and in any trouble. Lord, we thank you for that comfort, and we receive it for them right now in the name of Jesus. God, you're some kind of wonderful. You're some kind of wonderful.
Yes, you are.
And I'm so glad that this family knows you, and they know that they know they can depend on you. So it's by faith that we step out today with our heads lifted high, and our hearts might be full, but we're looking to you, Father God, because you are the great I am. And because of you, we can stand today and stand some more. We bless you and we thank you for Eddie. We thank you for this family. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
How many of you know that if God will look out for the beast in the field, certainly he'll take care of us? Come on and put your hands together and give God glory and his praise today.
Good afternoon, Saints.
Good afternoon.
Saints. May God bless Eddie Starla, his wonderful children, and the entire Davis family. We're going to miss our brother Eddie. Let us continue to celebrate his life by reading the obituary. Eddie Lee Davis Jr., known to family as Brother, was born on August the 5th, 1947 in Atlanta, Georgia, to Eddie Lee Davis Sr., deceased, and Grace Mae Jinks Davis. Born the second oldest of 10 children, Eddie attended Luther J. Price High School in Atlanta. When Eddie was young, he was introduced to cement and bricklaying work from several of his uncles who lived in Atlanta. At the age of 19, he attended Job Corps in Indianapolis, Indiana, where his passion for working with his hands grew. He moved to Detroit in 1972. He worked construction since that time. He worked at the Northville Psychiatric Hospital in food service for 12 years until he retired in 2003. Even after retirement, he couldn't sit still. He worked tirelessly, day in and day out. He was a real handyman. Eddie met the love of his life, Starla B. Kelly, in 1984. She was a tender 19, and he was 37. They married 3 years later on February 5th, 1987, on Starla's 22nd birthday. This union was blessed with three wonderful children, Gabriel, Angela, and Ariana. Next month, they would have celebrated their 29th wedding anniversary. Hallelujah. Eddie was a proud member, beloved member of the Rosedale Park Baptist Church, where he was on the usher board. He enjoyed it. We saw that every Sunday. After Eddie joined the church, he definitely became more easygoing. Although he was baptized as a child, he chose to get rebaptized in 2008. There was an instant camaraderie with his brothers that he met at Rosedale. He was also an active part of the community. Being a part of the neighborhood watch and serving as sergeant of arms and treasurer of his block club, he was a good nosy neighbor. He took pride in keeping his lawn well kept. He loved spending time with his family and watching The Price is Right, occasionally going to the casino, and watching Dateline every Friday night with his wife. Dateline, date night. Eddie was a good man, a good husband, and a caring father. He leaves to cherish his memory, his grateful wife, Starla, his son, Gabriel, his two daughters, Angela and Ariana, his mother, Grace Davis, five sisters, Gwendolyn Stone, Thomas, Belinda Horton, Dale Daniels, Judy Lofton, Robert, Alberta Thornton, Curtis. Four brothers, Robert Davis, Myra, Daniel from Atlanta, Daniel Davis, Jerome Davis, and Alonzo Davis. One aunt, Ruth Jinks, all from Atlanta, Georgia. Sister-in-laws, Chandra Holloway, Mary Jinks, Toya Kelly, brothers-in-law, Julius Kelly, Melvin Kelly. His good friend for more than 40 years, Thomas Williams, along with a host of other beloved relatives and friends.
My condolences are obviously to the family. My name is David Gordon. I serve as deacon at Rosedale Park Baptist Church. And I got to know Eddie when he came to our church. I was reading the obituary and it says that Eddie was baptized at an early age. But I remember Eddie coming to our new members classes. And he came for some months. You know, he would come. We would go through the lessons together. The lessons were taught by myself, Deacon Woodruff at that time. Eddie would not be late coming to class. He was here before class started. We went through various classes. We had classes on salvation, baptism, what it means to be a child of God. And Eddie would eat all of those classes up, you know, as he came each and every Sunday. He asked questions when he needed to. He went home and did homework. He brought back less answers to the questions that he had looked up. So Eddie got to know the Lord. He knew the Lord. He prayed and received Jesus Christ as his Lord and Savior. And I still remember him being baptized over in that corner, right over there. So right now, I know we're going to miss Eddie. Obviously, you're going to miss him when because he's gone. He's not here with us now. But we know where he is. If you want to know where he is, I can tell you, he's with Jesus Christ right now. And I know he's shouting on the streets of glory right now because he did know the Lord as his Lord and Savior. So be confident in knowing that Eddie is with the Lord. And if you want to see him, you need to go where he is because he is with the Lord right now. Praise God for these few moments.
Amen.
Amen.
Praise God. You know the most important thing, David, by the way, my name is Macy Weber, Jr. I'm a deacon here at Rosedale Park Baptist Church, and it's a pleasure to do this hard work sometimes. But the most important thing was said, that he was saved, he accepted Jesus Christ as his personal Savior. Isn't that wonderful?
Yes.
And those that of you that know it, tell those that don't know it, so they will know what he knew. He didn't know Jesus Christ, because he's wonderful. Being a country boy such as myself, the old people used to tell me something very simple. Starla, a friend is better than a dollar. Doesn't that sound weird? A friend is better than a big old dollar bill. Isn't that something? Eddie was a friend of mine. I praise God. He was over my house. Actually, I have pictures on my telephone. He was over my house 7 weeks ago for just food and fellowship. So I thank God for him. He's just down to earth. And what I lack about Eddie, now I'm not trying to say there's things wrong with me too, but being in my position to meet real down to earth people. You know one thing? I don't have time for all this old mess. People took Diddy all walking around the hair all messed up and stuff, all this stuff here, and they gonna die next. The scripture states very clearly, it is appointed to man once to die. We all got an appointment, so get out of yourself. Don't mean nothing, that's what I lack. Down to earth country people. Real country simple people. Forget about what you have and your education. Forget about your masters and all that old stuff. You're going to lay cross and you're going to die. So one thing, that's what I like about him. He was just a regular person. Thank God for him. And Stolly, you was blessed. You was blessed. We had classes together. He would come and talk about you. And he told me, with due respect to you, he said, I met this young girl. You know, they talk down, so he said, I married her. That means married, I guess. You know. He said, I married her. I said, okay, really? He said, I love her. And then, but the next thing he said, she accepted me. That's what Jesus did. He said, she accepted me just the way I was, with all that masters and everything else she had.
Hello.
The only thing she had at that time, being so young. but I just love the guy. He's a regular guy. Came there and ate and just enjoyed himself. But I just thank God for him and just continue on. And he left a great legacy behind him. And make sure his children went to school and stuff like that. And obey your mom. You're not going to like everything she say. You're going to try to get a little bad now. Start smelling yourself. With due respect to you. But if you do the right thing, there's a long life for you. Just do the right thing, okay? You know one thing? Never let nobody else lead you. Be your own leader. You're the captain of your ship in that school world. The captain is the last person that's supposed to get off the ship. So, in your little world at school, you're the captain. Stay on the ship. Thank God. Thank God for everybody here today. And start up. Keep your head up. Jesus is your Lord.
Amen. That's because he was different. And that's why I loved him and he loved me. We're going to give an opportunity for some of you, not all of y'all, because we're not going to be here all afternoon. You can be here. I'm going to be leaving later on. But with respect to the family, and I'm just simply following their orders. And if I can, you're in my house now, you're in my place. So if I can submit to them, I know y'all going to be able to submit to them. All right? Turn your neighbor and say, you better submit.
You better submit.
We want to give an opportunity for those of you who want to make remarks. Some of you knew him as neighbor and daddy and uncle and brother and whatever. We want to give you an opportunity to come up here and share some remarks. We have a member of the clergy. Why don't you come up first? I want to be here first because he's going to set the example. I said 2 to 3 minutes. And we're going to need leadership. We're going to see him. Come on up. We're going to see how many people can keep that time limit. Because there's going to be a bunch of you all, possibly, that want to share. But it's important that you out of respect to the family. Submit. You don't have time to tell them everything. And even after this service, they don't want to hear anything. Because you know, after a while, one person say, how you doing? Then another person say, how you doing? After 20 people saying, how you doing? I mean, you most want to get a little card. Just give it to them. All right, so I'm taking this time so all of you can think about what you're going to say before you get up here. All right, we're in a different church. This ain't your house. Don't get up here and say, I know what he said, but the Holy Spirit is talking to you right now. Submit to what the family wants. Amen?
Amen.
You say, well, I'm family. Well, I'm feeling that, but can we live with that?
Yeah. Right. I'm going to be obedient today. But I can tell y'all this, he kept it 100. Okay, I like to read
cards.
It's faith that lifts us up, love that brings us comfort and strength, that allows us to move on. Dear Starlin family, may you be touched by the healing power of prayer, feel the warmth of those who love you, and realize you have the courage to carry on. Our thoughts and prayers are with you in deepest sympathy. Blessings, the spirit of Esther. With sympathy in the loss of your father, passing time can never dim a father's love, your love for him. Your father will be with you always in so many ways with sympathy and caring. Love, Antoya, Vincent, Antonicia, Lionel, and Jamari. May God bless you with comfort. Blessed are they that mourn, for they shall be comforted. Matthew 5:4. May he wrap his arms around you and remind you of all the wonderful memories you can reflect on with sympathy. May God bless you and your family. My prayers are with your family, Belinda. God is with you in your time of loss. Closer than a falling tear, he's ever present and always near. Hope it comforts you to realize that God is with you every moment, along with all the thoughts and prayers of everyone who cares about you. You and your family are not thoughts and prayers, the Jackson family. The light of loving memories. On the journey through your sadness, there's a light that helps us find a tender reassurance and some peace of heart and mind. It's the light of loving memories with their gentle, guiding glow to grace our days and smooth our paths wherever we may go. May your warmest memories help to ease your grief and bring you comfort. With sympathy and sincere love for you and your family, Sheila, Angelo, and Jeanette.
Amen. Bless the Lord. Bless the Lord. Come on up, give us another song.
Can y'all hear me?
Oh.
All right. I just prepared a few things since my siblings didn't want to talk today. As you all know, Eddie was my father. So I just want to talk a little about when I, I was home together all week. When I went away to school, it was hard because I didn't know nobody. I mean, we got family in Alabama, but I hardly knew them. But I went away and I was kind of like, let me go to Alabama and try something new. And my family was in Georgia, so I knew if something happened that I could call them if anything ever happened. But when I went away, anybody who knows me know that I worry a lot, so I would worry about small things. But the more I went away, the more I prayed for peace and strength, because I knew that I had to grow up and, you know, just get outside the nest. So I prayed that God gave me peace. So throughout this entire process, since I was in Maryland, I knew there wasn't much I could do. So I tried to come home a little bit more. Because when I was at school, you know, I only came home at the beginning of the semester, at the end of the semester. So luckily I had family away that I stayed with. But when my dad was first diagnosed a year ago, I knew that I needed to step up and be as helpful as possible. So I began traveling home more throughout the year. And every time I would come home, my dad would say, because I would always surprise him. So I would tell my mom I'm coming home, tell her not to tell my dad or Ariana. And I would just walk in the door. And my dad would be like, what you doing here, woman? And I'm like, Dad, you know what I'm here for. I'm here for you. And so it was a little different. The last time I came home, the week before Christmas, because I wasn't sure if I was going to be off on my other job, I wasn't sure if I was going to get off for Christmas. So when I left the last time, instead of him saying, you know, what you doing or whatever, he said, don't be coming home if you only plan on staying for 3 days, because I would do like little short trips because I had to work. So he said, don't come home if you only going to stay for 3 days. But in my dad's language, what that really means is, I want to spend more time with you. I miss you. So, also, Pastor, I'm going to take my time. So if I go for 5 minutes, y'all going to have to bear with me. My stomach growling too. So growing up, people were always surprised to hear that my dad lived in the same household as me, because it's rare that you see a family who have their mother and their father. And I mean, growing up, you know, I didn't take it for granted, because I knew like most of my friends didn't have their father in the house. And so many people didn't get the experience that I had. And I tried not to take it for granted, but I just wanted to share a few memories that I had. One time I was, I don't know how old I was, but my dad did my hair. I don't know, my mom must have been at work, but he did my hair and he put them in these two puffs. The rubber band wasn't even tight. And I was like, he did my hair, and then he sent me outside. And when he sent us outside, he said, don't be running in and out of that house. So we had to stay. And I was just thinking about, it's a picture when we do the slideshow that y'all will see of him, me sitting in a chair, and he did my hair. And then even when he taught me how to ride a bike, you know, we were riding up the street, and I busted my lip. You know, I fell off that bike so hard. You know what my dad said? He said, get up and do it again. You talking about a tough man. That was my dad. And then even I was thinking about his coworkers and him doing food service. He used to bring us all types of snacks back from work. Everything. We had everything. Chips Ahoy, the white cheddar popcorn, the snack size, the large size. I mean, he used to bring snacks back all the time. And before, speaking of that, a lot of y'all, maybe my dad's coworkers, don't remember my sister because she was so much younger, but I was his road dog before my sister came along. Me and my dad went everywhere. He taught me how to mix some cement and mortar, lay some bricks. I don't don't need, I patched my own wall back in Maryland because I made a mistake and bust a hole in it. I was like, Dad, just tell me what I need. Put some spackle on it. My roommates were like, do you know what you're doing? I said, I don't know what I'm doing, so I don't have to pay this deposit. And I patched that wall up. He told me I did a good job. I was like, that's all I need to know. And then even being outside, my mom used to work at Chrysler. She would get back late, you know, she'd be overtime, it'd be like midnight or something. But in the summertime, we used to, my dad would have us sitting outside at like 1 o'clock in the morning, just playing up and down the street because we was waiting for my mom to get back. So I was talking to my aunt Belinda the other day when she first got here, and I was telling her, you know, I never seen my dad cry a day in my life. So I was telling her, and she was like, yeah, you know, your dad is a soldier. And I thought about it, and I was like, throughout this whole process, my dad, he never cried, he never complained. Mm-hmm. And he was so strong. He never went throughout this whole thing. So he never not once let us see him weak. And even when he was tired, he would just go sit.
Look. So I said, what is Bonnie? And he said, I don't know, who's Bonnie? I said, well, you got it in your book. Who is Bonnie? So he said, girl, you crazy. He said, I was crazy. So I showed him his book.